But I think we are actually a collection of interacting perspectives and interacting consciousnesses. And, you know, then sometimes people say, well, I don't feel my liver being conscious. Right, you don't, but you don't feel me being conscious either. Of course you don't. And the fact that your left hemisphere has the language ability for us to sit here and talk about it and the liver doesn't actually mean that it's not conscious. It just means that we don't have direct access to it and we don't have direct access to each other. So that doesn't bother me. So that's my suspicion about consciousness, is that for the same reason that people think it's in the brain, we should take very seriously that it's in other places in the body. And then more generally, other types of constructs that are not human bodies at all, or not even animal bodies.
You've spoken to Bernardo Kastrup several times now. What is it you agree with him the most that you think most people would disagree about? Because you agree with him that it's nice to go for a walk. Okay, sure, but most people agree it's nice to go for a walk. So what is it that you agree with him about that you think is a contentious issue to most people? So this is a controversial statement. And then what is it you disagree with him about regarding consciousness?
Yeah, boy, I don't, you know, it's hard for me to know what most people agree or disagree with him about. I really don't know. We agree on a lot of things. We agree on, I think, the primacy of consciousness. I think that his idealist position has a lot to recommend it. The one thing I think we disagree on is the issue of compositionality. So if I recall correctly from a talk that we had together a little while ago, he felt that it is important in order to be a true self, to have a conscious experience as an inner perspective. You have to be, you know, he focuses on the view of embryonic development as a single system that, you know, whatever subdivides and develops, but it starts out as a single system. And I was arguing that really is just a contingent feature of biology. I mean, we certainly can take two early embryos and mush them together. You get a perfectly normal, you know, embryo out of it. And in general, there are lots of biological systems like our xenobots, like arthropods, that you can create by composition, by pulling other things together. So I don't give as much, I don't put as much emphasis on a system being demarcated from the outside world because it was somehow, because it started out that way and it sort of remained, disconnected. I think that's kind of a superficial aspect of the biology, and you can do things a different way. I don't think that's what's responsible for it. But I think he thinks it's important that individual selves are not compositions. They're not made as compositions. They're somehow individualized from the word go, which again, even the egg, right? So we humans like eggs because we can see it as a distinct little thing with a membrane and say, there's an individual. But even an egg is composed by the maternal organism from molecular components. I see no point at which any of this is truly distinct from anything else. So I put less emphasis on it, but I think he thinks it's important.
It seems like the point that you're saying is, look, we can think about this as several rooms. This building comprises several rooms, but even in, and Bernardo may say that's what makes a person is the distinct rooms, but you're saying, yeah, but even in a room, there are different people, there are different chairs, there are different tables. Is that what you're saying?
What I'm saying is, and I may not be doing justice to his view, and I think you should ask him more about this, but I think he thinks that it's important in order to be a unified. So I think we were discussing what makes for a unified inner perspective, right? So we don't feel like billions of individual brain cells. I mean, I have no idea. Well, we kind of do because that's what it feels like to be billions of individual cells of neurons. That's really what it feels like. But we do feel, at least most of us, most of the time, feel like some kind of unified, centralized inner perspective. And so we were talking about how that comes about. And I think he felt that having that in the physical universe is importantly related to arising from a single origin. So he sees the egg as a single point of origin, and arising from that, that's how you are a separate individual from others. And I see it as much more fluid, and I see the boundary between self and world as something that can change all the time. I think it changes in embryogenesis, and that's the story of the scaling of the cognitive light cone that we talked about. I think it can shrink during cancer. I think it can change during metamorphosis, during maturation. I think it's much more fluid than that.
Now, as we're on speculative ground, if what makes an agent is the distinction between the self and the world, and some people think of God as the entirety of everything, thus the entire world, and there's no distinction, then can one say that God is an agent?
I don't know. I mean, certainly I think most, religions that have a God anyway, as far as my understanding is, they would think that, yes, the God has extreme agency, in fact, higher than ours. I don't know what that really buys us, helpful way.
Remove the word God. Does the world have agency?
Okay, so that's an interesting question. So let's start with, first of all, how do we know when anything has agency? And that's an experimental research program. So you hypothesize what problem space it's working in, what you think its goals are, and then you do experiments to figure out what competency it has. And then you find out, did I guess well, poorly? Do I need to make a better guess? And so on. So for example, people have said to me, well, you know, your kind of panpsychist almost view says that the weather should be, cognitive. And I say, I don't say that it is or isn't because we haven't done the experiments. Do I know that weather systems, let's say hurricanes or so on, do I know that they don't show habituation sensitization, that they couldn't be trained if you had the right scale of machinery? I have no idea. But what I do know is that it's not a, this is not a philosophical thing that we can decide arguing in an armchair. Yes, it is. No, it isn't. No, you have to do experiments and then you find out. So now the question is, okay, so what about, you know, the galaxy? What about the universe, right? Are these the, you know, Gaia ecosystems? Again, I think these are all empirical questions. Now, some of them are intractable. We don't have the capability to do experiments on a planetary scale. But for example, one thing that I did try to do once was design a gravitational synapse. So design a solar system-sized arrangement where masses would fly in, and based on the history of masses flying in, it would respond to new masses in a different way. So you can do, you know, historicity, and you can have habituation and sensitization and things like that. So could you have something like that would be very sort of ponderously, slowly on an enormous scale, computing something and having, you know, sort of simple thoughts? I bet you could. Is the real universe doing that? I have no idea. We have to do experiments. So you know, here you bump up against another question, which is, how do you know if and when you are part of a larger cognitive system, right? So I don't, you know, how do we know if we are in fact part of a bigger mind? So I don't know. My suspicion is that there are some sort of Gödel-like theorem that will tell you that you can never know for sure. And you can never be certain, but I bet that you could gather evidence for it, well, for or against. And I often think about, a kind of a mental image. Just imagine two neurons in the brain, and one is a kind of a strict materialist, and one's a little more mystical. And the one neuron says, "Look, we just run on chemistry, and the outside world is a cold mechanical universe, and it doesn't care what we do. There's no mind outside of us." And the other one says, "Can't prove it, but I kind of feel like there's an order to things, and I kind of feel like our environment is not stupid. I kind of feel like our environment wants things from us." And I kind of feel these waves these waves back propagating through us that are like almost rewards and punishments. I feel like the universe is trying to tell us something. And the first one says, "Yeah, you're just seeing, you know, faces in clouds. It doesn't exist." And of course, in my example, the second one is correct, because they are in fact part of a larger system. They're part of a brain that is learning things, and it's very hard for any one node in that system to recognize that, or even a sub network. But I wonder if we could, having a degree of intelligence ourselves, if we could gain evidence that we were part of a larger system that was actually processing information. And I don't know exactly what that would look like, but my hunch is that it would look like what we call synchronicity. I think that what it would look like are coincidences, are events that don't have a causal connection at our lower level, like mechanistically, like by physics, there's no reason why that should be. But at a larger scale, in terms of meaning and the greater meanings of things, that they do have some kind of interpretation. And I think that's what it would look like to be part of a larger system. I think it would look and feel like synchronicity. So does it exist? I don't know, but that's what I think it would feel like.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.